Hello, everyone. I am absolutely thrilled to be with you today at ChangeNOW. We are all very busy. There's lots of noise. So I will ask you to start to do a clean slate. We're going to close our eyes all together. And we're going to take 3 deep breaths all together. I know it's busy outside, there's a lot of noise, we've been meeting so many people, so we need to center first, and we're going to talk about inner change, so that's actually really important to center ourselves first. Whenever you're ready, we're gonna breathe 3 times with consciousness. Okay, whenever you're ready, you can open your eyes or you can keep them closed if you prefer. And I don't know for you, but I already feel much better and much more calm. Okay, so I am really happy to be with you today. I'm really excited about this coming session because our amazing guests are going to show us how connecting to our deep consciousness, we did a little bit right now, and using the power of our imagination are absolutely vital in driving systemic change. To make it really short, we won't change the world if we don't change ourselves and raise our level of consciousness. That's basically what we're going to tackle. And I think we are quite a lot of ourselves agree to that right now. The first speaker is Erik Fernholm. He's the initiator and co-founder of Inner Development Goals. He will tell us all about it in 1 second. He's also the co-founder of 29K Platform. He's coming from neuroscience and chose to be a bridge builder for the last 15 years, creating social initiatives to build a more sustainable world. The main question he's going to tackle with his work is, if human being is the problem, how can it be the solution? Ladies and gentlemen, please make a round of applause for Erik Fernholm.
Thank you. Hello. Can you guys hear me? Okay, perfect, thank you. So, I kind of want to keep the consciousness that Laura framed for us here, and I want to throw you into an experiment. Is that okay? Some nods, some people are like, I don't know what that means, I don't trust you. Okay? So this experiment may raise some emotions, some reactions, that's the point. So just try to see if you can hold it. Ready? Ready?
Yes.
Ah, okay, yeah. Are we back? Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so let's dive in. I'll shoot some questions for you guys to just sense into. First one, out of the global biomass for mammals on the planet, how much is humans and our cattle? 22%, 73%, 11%, or 98%? What do you think? So the answer is 98%. There are more tigers in captivity in the United States than there are tigers in the wild on the planet. Just let that sink in. So this is more or less our game. We are the ones at the wheel, right? Next one. What kills more people globally? Terrorism, murder, war, or suicide? Exactly. Suicide actually kills more than terrorism, murder, war combined each year. Crazy. Third one. How many people are engaged at work globally? Not who think that everything is fun, but who care about what they're doing. 15%, 73, 68, or 32. Now you're getting to know me, right? So you're like, take the worst. 15%, correct. 15% have intrinsic motivation, they care what they do. Lastly, how much has the insect population decreased during the last 20 years according to numerous studies? This is mainly across Europe. 15%, 73, 68, or 80%? The answer is 80%. So when I was young, you took a drive in the summertime in Sweden, you had to stop and clear the windshield. When was the last time you had to do that? Even though it's spring, turning into summer. I can't even remember when I had to do that the last time. And that's a scary fact. So I asked you guys to kind of hold space for this. So what's happening in you when you hear these data points? Is it deflection? Like, this doesn't really matter that much? Is it questioning the data behind? Is it overwhelm of saying, like, this is too big for us to cope with? Or opposing reaction could be, but we are the change. Let's be the change. Maybe too early identifying with the change. So no matter how we are reacting here, the intrinsic, the internal aspect of these challenges that we're facing is kind of put to the forefront here, right? And throughout the external system we're looking at, you know, you could look at the SDGs and say them as, you know, instead of the global goals, you say they're the global symptoms, but just reformulated into positive aims, right? But this is the effect that our human activity is having on the planet at scale. Mass extinction at a rate that's, you know, thousands of times faster than the baseline. Systemic symptoms. And the root cause is, the root cause has basically two things in common. One, all these existential threats that we're facing are global. And secondly, they're caused by human behavior. They're caused by us. Just hold with that. Hold that a second. Because nobody wakes up in the morning aiming to have the problems that we are creating. I'm just guessing that nobody wakes up in the morning like, hope we have more species extinction. So on one level, we could say that the old paradigm in our society for the last maybe 400 years of linearity, separation, individualism is kind of coming to its end because it's obviously not sustainable. And I mean, listen to the story we have of happiness. Like, what is driving the systemic symptoms? The story we have of happiness is basically get on top of this pyramid and make an exit. Make an exit from the system that you don't want to be part of anymore. Like, sell your company, make an exit, become financially independent so you're free and wealthy enough to do whatever you want with no relationship to any other system. In psychology, we talk about an individual who has those types of traits as a psychopathic narcissist. But in markets, we say that that's the goal, right? The problem with this model is it's basically this. Which is the fastest way to win the most when you're running up a hierarchy? It's quite easy. Care less and sacrifice more. The more you can externalize onto other things than your metric, the faster you can move. And this is not because we have bad actors. This is because the game is kind of rigged in that way. So this is where we're coming from. This is very much the lens through which we see the world. And this is also why the way that we are solving problems today in the world is very much the problem. The way that we're solving problem is the problem. So this industrial way of looking at the world, where we own it, we own nature, and we can extract whatever value we want out of it, I mean, it is very effective, and that's the trap as well. It's great at simple or complicated problems that kind of require technical solutions, like building an airplane, technical challenge. Heart surgery, technical challenge. But what we're facing now is not a complicated environment, it's very much a complex environment, where there is no blueprint, basically. And the approach can't be an approach where we just think that we need a blueprint and can solve it, but we need an adaptive approach that really changes the learner in itself. So we're facing adaptive challenges at a global scale. And this, of course, means that we need to change to be able to face it. And that there may be a trap also with identifying with being the solution too early before we're learning enough where we are the solution and where in my life, for sure, I am actually still the problem more than I am the solution. So just sense in what's happening in you, if you're maybe both the solution and the problem. So, if we know that the internal world of individuals and groups are fundamental for this massive transition that society has to go through, we also know that the internal worlds have to transform themselves as well. And I know Jakob Trollbeck, who actually designed the SDGs for the United Nations, that was part of that process. So, I talked to him and said, I mean, aren't we facing a similar problem for the internal dimensions of the world that we are part of that needs to change as well, to bring forth these kind of external transformations of all these interlapping systems? And Jakob, he, of course, being a designer, he's like, yes, we need to be much more clear and succinct to give people a map to talk about, much like the SDGs has given us a way to talk about what the external problems may be and how they interlink, instead of saying my problem is the most important problem and competing with everybody else in the sustainability world, right? So having a map and having a language for it is what we started exploring through one question. And this took some of the brightest minds on the planet a couple of months to actually arrive at. And this is the question. What capabilities, qualities, or skills do you believe are essential to develop individually and collectively in order to get us significantly closer to fulfilling the Sustainable Development Goals? Just think about what your answer would be. Now, we asked 4,000 experts around the world this, mainly biased to Europe, though, because we're a Scandinavian initiative from the beginning. It's now expanding to 2 million people throughout the entire globe, especially focusing on native cultures and the global south. And then we brought all that data back and we asked our scientific advisors and networks of scientists, like among these, some of them, one of them is in the audience, but some of them you may know as well otherwise. And tried to boil it down and say, what is the kind of essence of this with statistical analysis, but also looking at the research. And what we came out with was actually these, the inner development goals, to mirror the SDGs and saying what internal transformation has to take place or can be a pivotal leverage point so that we can work on ourselves in our environments to create the capacity to care and act on wicked problems, because we're not trained in that, we're not schooled in that. So how can we build these capacities? And from my point of view, maybe this is more important than us trying to convince people who don't really act for the SDGs. I mean, you know, the time is short and we haven't arrived at a lot of results in the last couple of years. So what is blocking us? I mean, mainly it's people understanding the complexities and still caring instead of shutting off when it becomes really heavy, right? So
The founding partners are the new division. That's Jakob Trollbeck, who designed the SDGs. It's 29K, a nonprofit platform to scale inner development for free to everybody. It's a platform that's available. You can download it today. And the Oak Island Foundation, which has been working with the research around this for a long time. So we started this from this idea that maybe something here could be needed, maybe something could be useful for someone, basically. And what we found was almost like a tsunami of response that was global. People started reaching out to us from global companies, small initiatives, social entrepreneurship. We even had the president of Costa Rica call us and said, I want to implement this in the entire Costa Rican government, because we feel that we want to pioneer the SDGs, but we also feel that we aren't getting the traction that we need, and to have a conversation at least around the inner dimensions that are kind of blocking us or that can catalyze us would help us a lot. So I've talked about the kind of path to this and the context in which we sit, at least. So what is the result? Where do we end with these questionnaires and the science behind it? And it's basically five categories and 23 skills that all of them are evidence-based, and there's evidence-based tools that can measurably impact all of these, and they're also connected to how people can approach and care about really wicked, complex problems. So just to give you guys a short overview. So being, relationship to self. Like, where do you believe that you begin, and where do you believe that you end? Is it your ownership? Is it your body? Is it your family? If you look at a bee and a flower, is that a bee, a bumblebee, and a flower separate, or are they actually one system because they can't exist without the other? So defining the bumblebee or the flower without the opposite system would be nonsensical, right? So where do you end? And if you start shifting the perspective through these skills, you see that we've been told a story that we are separate from everything else, but actually what we're rediscovering is that things are very much more entangled than we thought that they were. Like behavior, for example. If I gain 10 kilos and you're a good friend of mine, the chance of you gaining 10 kilos is 157% higher because of me. Spreading my memes, spreading my behavior towards you. Okay? And it goes the opposite way as well. Like if you start exercising, or if you vote, or if we're this mesh of behaviors, you're not a separate individual. You have never been. Thinking, of course, this is more of cognitive capacities to address and see complexity, see systems, and care for them. Relating, kind of obvious maybe. Collaboration skills, like how do we also act together? How do we seek more perspectives than only our own, and acting. So these are the categories that kind of emerged from the data of what we saw. So I want to end with not going into any one of these, because you could do that later on, and there's a lot of research, of course, and we only have a short time, but I want to invite you to sense a little bit into this instead. So please close your eyes. For those of you who are sleeping, that's easy. No, I'm kidding. please close your eyes. Take a deep breath. Okay, now just imagine that you're not at the ChangeNOW conference. You're not here, but you're 30 years into the future. And I have really great news. The news is, we made it. Like, you are proud of what we humans have created. When you think about the old stories of existential risk and the SDGs, it's almost like a cute memory, because we navigated through all that complexity. And you look down at your hands, and you see that they're a lot older and more wrinkly than today. And in one of your hands is the hand of maybe your grandchild. So if we arrived, how are you different? What changes did you have to go through? What stories of who you are, where you end, where you begin, had to change? What time horizons had to change? For you to say that I know in my bones that we are living not only a sustainable life, but a life that is generating a planet that we are proud to hand off to the next generation. Okay, so welcome back to the present. So this is the Change Now conference, right? And with two exclamation marks. And I love the urgency of it, like I honestly do. And I'm so proud to be here. But it does also raise the question, when you read that, who was it aimed towards? Who was going to change now? Was it the business? Was it other people? Because we are already the solution? Or was it you and I? Because if we are already the solution, we're not that curious, we're not that open, we're not seeking more perspectives for where we can learn, where we can change, right? So if I could ask for anything, basically, it would be, how can we build the collective capacity and language to make sure that what we're changing now is the capacity maybe to hold uncertainty before we shut down or grab a solution that we say, this is an impact investment. Even though deep down, if we dig into it, maybe it's not shifting the system in the direction we really know holistically that it needs to go, right? Thank you very much.